November 12th meeting of the planning board. We start every meeting with an opportunity for public comment on any item that's not on the agenda, so it's an opportunity to introduce new topic, going once, going twice. Yes, sir.
Well, good evening, I'm Jonathan Wright from 91 Elevator Drive. This is not about anything pending, anything specific. But a lot of conversation and communication has happened over recent weeks about what design standards govern Village Hill and were adopted by whom. And so it's clear that there's a Beals and Thomas report that it, from, that it is basically site design and some other massing things, which I think is, was adopted by the planning board. It is in your file cabinet. There also is, for all the residential developers, CBT, which is a Boston architecture firm, developed, and we were there as they were birthed, residential design guidelines. And those don't appear anywhere in your files, but they are actually governing for all the developers. So at the risk of being excessive, or I have three copies, and I'm gonna just put them here. If I would think it might be useful for you to know what it is that has governed the relationship between developers and Village Hill, and why it is that Village Hill looks the way it does, which is why it's so attractive. And that's not in the Beals and Thomas guidelines that you have approved. It's in different guidelines. So they're here. And if you're restless, can't sleep.
Mr. Wright, do you have, do the developers sign on to that in any formal way?
It's required
by
mass development, but it is enforced, as we have experienced, very unevenly. It requires certain things that have been overlooked.
Thank you
so much. Appreciate it.
Do you want these back after my 9?
No, those will balance your file cabinet very well.
Future events.
See you later. Is it a new sound system?
It's the same microphone. We don't have anything.
Okay. Sorry. The,
we have monitor behind you is sort of working on it.
Okay.
So, the, yeah, so just so everyone knows, everything is down. There's no recording except for this little tiny, terrible video camera in the back. That's running. But this is in transition, I have all this stuff. But I think the next one is everything will be back.
No.
Okay, well, I'd like to open the first item on the agenda, which is 7 o'clock site plan review of 5,600 square feet expansion, Smith Street Associates LLC 32-36 Smith Street, Northampton. Map ID 32C-107. Is there a presentation?
Before Jeff starts, I need to make my usual Birch Design disclaimer that we have in the past and are currently working with Birch Design, my business. And I don't think it prevents me from being objective on this particular presentation, but if anybody feels differently, please raise your hand and I can recuse myself from this hearing.
I do need to recuse myself.
Glad we're full house tonight.
So Jeff Squire from the Berkshire Design Group here on behalf of Ralph's Blacksmith Shop. They currently own property on Smith Street, a split zone parcel. We did get a UDA finding earlier this evening for the addition. Just came to Conservation Commission, we got approved over there. What they're looking to do is they've got, if you look at the site plans on the left side of this building, there's a partial steel substructure that was constructed a number of years ago, never fully enclosed. What they would like to do is enclose that and, you know, obviously a little bit more, 5,600 square foot footprint. Right now, a lot of the sandblasting operations are outside of that end of the building, so they're looking to enclose all that. We've shown areas for restoration to comply with the River Protection Act, satisfy all the Conservation Commission issues. But aside from that, it's really a sealed building that's existing. Move a lot of operations inside. So, no new lighting, no new parking. Won't generate any more need for employees or anybody else, just in case when we come to the operations from outside, we'll be inside.
Questions? Yes?
Just a question, the letter, the cover letter that accompanied the application, says the project will reduce the peak stormwater flows due to the reduction of compacted gravel and concrete paving.
Right.
But isn't it being replaced with a metal building?
So the, it is being, like, the difference in, the coefficient difference between compacted gravel and a rooftop is, you know, a couple percent. It's 98 to 100%, something like that, versus the restoration areas that we're proposing, which are taking that 98% and making them, you know, permeable soils. We're going to scarify it, we're going to put topsoil down. So it's that exchange for that gravel area, and basically the same square footage as the building, that we're taking from gravel and converting back to, you know, natural soil.
So it's changing the permeability of an area of the ground.
Yes.
Rather than replacing the compacted parking lot with a metal building.
I'm sorry, it's...
You're increasing the permeability by altering the structure of the, some part of the soil?
The gravel, right, the gravel parking, right, right.
I thought you were referring to the riverfront area.
Well, that's the restoration area. So that restoration area now is compacted gravel that they stockpile on. What we're proposing to do is scarify it down so that it's not as compacted anymore, put 6 inches of topsoil on top of that and conservation mix on top of that. So that, yeah.
So there's no new lighting, the existing lighting that's there is just going to be...
Yeah, there'll probably be some emergency lighting over, you know, I think they're going to have one or two doors on that, and that's going to be the extent of it. Yeah, there's no other lighting.
I don't really have a concern with the addition. It's the addition is basically bringing what was stored outside inside.
Mm-hmm.
But my concern would be if what is now being restored becomes outside storage down the line.
So we did talk, that we just had that conversation with the Conservation Commission and what they agreed to, because usually they like to delineate, you know, the wetland boundary and mm-hmm. conservation areas. So what they agreed to, I'm going to speak with Ralphs about, you know, building some steel guardrail or something along that edge to define that, so they won't do just what you're saying. Because I think that's what's happened over the years, is it's just gradually expanded. So we're going to delineate that to something a little bit more concrete. And, you know, luckily they should have some materials available to do that. So.
Any other questions? Because it's enclosed space, are you doing anything inside that that would involve gases?
Not that I'm aware of. No. Just the material stockpile area and the sandblasting operation.
Is there need to be any sort of future accommodation of that space potentially becoming box space? You know, as far as parking is concerned, anything else, or is it based purely on intended current use?
It's based on current use. So they change, let's say, if a new owner comes in and doesn't want to do industrial or manufacturing of any kind, they want to change to office, then we have to look at the parking on site and potentially. If the same owner changes functionality, reduces the industrial component, and adds office space, we might also look at it at that point, depending on how much, you know, if they take over a significant portion of the building, that might trigger a reevaluation too, I guess is what I'm saying. But no, what's in front of you is proposed office use, so as long as it stays, I mean, industrial use, so as long as it stays that way, then that's what you're doing.
Open it up for public hearing. Anyone have any comments about this project? Move to close public hearing.
Close.
Before we do, just a quick question. The CONSCOM, was it specific on their the methodology to delineate future creep, you know, on the exterior, or was it just a general consensus that, yeah, you should do something, or
no,
where we need to make a condition, or if we can just defer to the CONSCOM?
We do have to submit final plans showing how we're going to delineate that edge to them before construction can start. So, yeah, one of the conditions of their permit, we have to submit plans to them first.
Okay.
And they'll be bound by the permit from the Conservation Commission, so if there's a violation, then that would be enforced through the Conservation Commission.
Right, so we don't need to add an additional...
There's, on the write-up here, on the detailed project information, number three, I think it's a missing word. It says the addition will not increase the number of employees and therefore new parking is proposed.
DPW had no concerns with the project, and we didn't have any concerns. This went to the zoning board earlier as well. Zoning board, I didn't have an issue with it.
And we know the plan to approve.
Should
we
close public hearing?
Second.
Yes, and Dan. Any further board discussion? Seems rather straightforward. Sherlyn pegged it within 3 minutes of how long it's
taken. Motion to approve site plan. First, next year associates 32-36 Street, FID 32C-1.
All in favor? Thank you.
Thank you.
Up near JFK. So, A large lot, not going down to 50 feet, but a new lot and well over the minimum speed, 3,750 square feet, 6,260 feet of frontage.
Just splitting big lots, is that what it is?
Yeah.
So, you're Brooklyn. You are Brooklyn.
So far away.
Well, we can tell you, yeah, we keep a list of all the A&Rs for the year. Some of them I might not remember, they were, so we have, you know. Okay, 7:15, I'd like to open the agenda item for the preliminary subdivision for 21 lots in Side Boy and some construction of Northwest Regional Road and Forest Crossing.
Good evening, Lawrence Lloyd from Kempton Clement Sons Construction Company. We have been developing a series of single family house lots up in Village Hill that largely has been concentrated in the Moser Street Ford Crossing area of the property. More recently, we've also started in a very small condominium that will have 6 units on the side of the road. We've been delighted to be part of that project. And really quite surprised at the absorption rate of what we built up there, which much to the delight of our bank. Several months ago, Mass Development, working on their master plan for the property, indicated to us that a small parcel of land contiguous to where we were building was coming available for sale, a little under 5 acres, and they went out with an RFP looking for the lot. We bid on it, and I understand there were several bidders on the property. And finally, we were awarded the winning bid for the property. So we've spent some time with Mass Development talking about conceptually about what we'd like to do there in terms of this subdivision. We have signed a contract to buy the property that's subject to approval by the planning board, so we're in the process of working on that. We have also done quite a lot of work with Fussin O'Neill, who serves as our land planning and engineering expert. I'm joined here tonight by John Allard, who will step us through a subdivision plan in a moment, and Eric Bernardin, who will also have a chance to speak. But before I do that, I just wanted to make one other comment. We sent out an invitation to area residents to come to see a short presentation that we put on, and we held a meeting this past Tuesday evening at the model home on Moser Street. The meeting was fairly well attended by residents. There were a lot of questions asked, a lot of comments made. But I think what came out of that meeting was the understanding by the residents that Mass Development has decided to sell the property, that it will get developed. And I think they were largely happy to hear that we were the winning bidder and would look at this parcel as a 21 lot single family home subdivision that would be in keeping of what we've already built up there. So it would be a continuation of the same neighborhood, same designs of plans, same floor plans, same price point for all the homes that would be offered there. So with that, I'd like to ask John to come up and walk us through the presentation.
Could you speak up too so we can hear in the back? Thank you.
Sure. Good evening. I'm John Allard, landscape architect for Fussin O'Neill. I'm just going to be walking you through the site plan for the new development just north of the Moser Street development. Just to get everyone oriented, this is the parcel up north of the Moser development there.
We need to see it too.
We're talking about the development of the housing just north of Moser Street. It's right here. It's a 5.5 acre property. Three housing units are fronting on Fort Cross. And the other 18 will be almost in a cluster design within the development area. We are coming directly off of Village Hill Road, directly across from it. Comes a design situation. We have the existing bike trail that runs south to 66, ending when it hits Fort Cross right here. So in our plan, it is we are bringing it through the actual site. It's a 10-foot-wide concrete walk, and eventually will be connected to the future development and across the Mill River. Not in this. So making our way into the site, we do have retaining walls, mainly because the site from Ford Crossing to the back is about 45 or 50 feet in grade shape. So there's a lot of challenges with that. So we're coming into the site and we're coming down downhill. We have a 20-foot wide road that's not only for infiltration, better infiltration of this site, so less impervious. It's also to slow down the traffic. I mean, you're coming downhill. It's not a giant hill, but you're coming downhill, so cars will tend to be a little bit faster. So kind of skinning that up a little bit will help with the safety. Once we get down to the split here, it would be a one-way around, 14 feet wide, and they'll have some parking, some pervious paving within the parking area. Coming around the corner right here where it splits off, where we have the bike trail. We'll continue a 5-foot walk all along the perimeter of the center green there, and resulting back up into a crossing. The crossing will be at grade. It'll have some lighted bollards for safety, and the way.
Excuse me. Where's the bike path?
I'm sorry. It's located on the east of. The entry road here.
It follows
along, okay. And then breaks off. It's going to break off into a future development, and then potentially across the river, the Mill River. The houses are centered around the center green. The center green, we did investigate putting larger rain gardens for infiltration. There's a lot of grading going on with that. As I said, it was a site that had a massive grading. 45 feet in grade change. So rather than digging up the entire center green area and making it not really usable, we decided to include an underground infiltration in that area so that we could kind of flatten out the center green and it would be usable for the community as picnic or play. And other kind of LID, low impact development that we have included in each building, similar to the Mosier Street development, are infiltration packs that will take the rainwater from the roof, infiltrate into the ground. I already talked about the pervious paving. We have a rain garden and the infiltration in the center drain there. And I will now swing it to Eric, because Eric can talk about the utilities and kind of pick up where I left off.
Thanks, John. Again, I'm Eric Bernard, Vice President of Fussing on the Air. So I think I'll just wrap up with just a few things. So there's
Can everyone
C?
Can everyone see her here? Would you like me to spin it? Occasionally?
We need to walk back and forth.
So I think a couple of things John was talking about, the 10-foot wide sort of multi-use trail heads along the east side of the roadway, and then there's a existing trail right now that heads through there, an old trail and road, so we'll make the connection to that through this property, and then it will continue as it naturally is. Over on the west side, there is an older trail that's more overgrown that then goes down to the utility crossing against the Mill River. I know that the planning board is interested in maintaining the right, or the planning department, I should say, is interested in maintaining the right to, in the future, develop that as something more than what it is now. So we're adding a path there that will have a right-of-way and an easement to the city so that future, so that it would accommodate future development to that. As far as utilities are concerned, we'll be coming off of, there are some stubs out off of Ford Crossing right now that we'll go ahead and utilize for a few of the units, and then there will be utilities that sort of go down through the street for water, sewer, electric, cable, and so forth. The sewer line itself will actually be, we'll have a private pump station at the back of the lot because this does grade downward, and that is proposed to remain private, and that will be, there will be a homeowners association that will be maintaining that, and that will bring the sewerage back up into the gravity system, into the town, or the city-owned system. So I think that's for utilities.
Okay, any questions on any three topics? Yeah, I think there was not. Carolyn's gonna walk
so
through it.
This is just to refresh everybody's memory. This is a preliminary subdivision plan, so not all the engineering has been complete. So they've got this basically concept. There's no permit that's issued at the end of this hearing. It's just a direction you're going to give the applicant one way or the other. You know, this plan is terrible, go back and redesign the whole thing, or this is great, you're on the right track, but we'll reserve rights to, you know, make more detailed comments at the definitive subdivision stage. So there's not actually any permit that goes on for this, so I just want to make that clear. The next round will be definitive subdivision and site plan approval. So similar to the project that you have looked at on the other side, those will probably come in tandem to, you know, together. So you'll look at the site plan of the build out of the lots around the street, plus the very detailed engineering of the street itself in a definitive subdivision format. And then that's the actual permit that can, you know, go to record. And that also has its own public hearing process and notification to the abutters.
So it feels like a two-way street where we're not having all the engineering work paid for a direction that they wouldn't go. And yet, if the plan as presented follows in the general vein of what we looked at and we had previously agreed to, I think we would intend to hold it and stay the course.
So the thing that would be important, that there are a couple of waivers that are requested, it would be important for the board to act on the waivers, even though you don't see full detailed plans, just sort of giving a direction about whether or not you think those waiver requests are appropriate, because for sure some of them would dictate whether or not they could go on this path. So those are the items that you'd want to make comment about. And DPW has, I sent you in the packet, DPW gave you some detailed comments, mostly about the fact that they didn't see much engineering, but again, you know, it's preliminary, so you wouldn't expect that at this stage. They did weigh in on the couple of waiver requests. There was an item that would normally be a waiver request, it wasn't requested, but they're showing concrete curbs. That's not allowed in subdivision regs, require granite. So, you know, they would in any event need to request that in order to do something other than granite on the external.
So confirm that you got the DPW comment.
I did, and I actually did have a conversation with David Valletta about some of the comments, just to talk about which ones should be presented tonight and which ones are the detailed ones for later. And I did follow up with Carolyn about it. I would like to comment on just maybe one of the comments. And that is on the concrete curb. That's a detail. This, because it's an LID subdivision, the road is actually not crowned and it's one way, so the road drains towards the green in the center where we have the rain garden and infiltration. And because we have pervious pavers, a lot of the typical details are just to put a gravel shoulder on the asphalt paving. But when you do traditional neighborhood developments like this where it's so tight, you need to use better construction details. So that concrete curb is actually a flush mounted curb on the interior side of the roadway to actually reinforce the pavement base. So it's truly the curb on the uphill side, which is exposed and has a 6 foot exposed face, 6 inch, excuse me, exposed face, is proposed to be granted. So.
Okay, well, your note is down on the entryway for concrete curbing.
Oh, it is?
Yeah.
Okay, so just clarify that. So.
Okay. So, fair to say, we need to think about the concrete and the inner circle to be an extension of the runoff roadway itself, and therefore it's not a curb proper.
Well, there is a provision in the subdivision regulations that states that if they're doing an LID system, which this really would be, they're using the inner green as the area for runoff, that the subdivision allows for that. So that can, you know, you'll review it when definitive comes because you want to see the drainage calculations and make sure that in fact they are handling that stormwater there. All the other curbing should be granite, so you can certainly, I think that's been hashed out, that right. It was intended right. To be the exterior as granite and just the where the LID is, but the subdivision rules do allow for that.
The waivers are pretty short. Can I indulge reading them real quick? The one was for street width, so the dimensions around the loop are less for the one-way street than would be under code. The second was instead of a 500 foot limitation, they're asking for approximately 900 feet on the proposed cul-de-sac length. And there was a two-way vehicle flow was waived for the one-way loop. So those, for your information, would be the waivers they're asking for. And I think I know the answer to this, but we don't actually have guidance on permeable pavers, do we?
You mean sort of specs on what type?
Mm-hmm.
No, and the idea really is that it's the type of unit used is based on the site conditions,
mm-hmm.
And sort of what combination of things are used. So we would wait to see how that fleshes out in terms of engineering. Sort of those things.
So could we ask them to give us before and after data?
Sure. I mean, we're going to have that information anyway because they're going to have to do annual stormwater reporting. So it's sort of wrapped into the stormwater permit.
Right. I can think of one other project we've done where we did a pump station that was private. You might want to walk us through what the implications of that are.
Yeah, I mean, we've done it a couple of times. And it's all maintained by the association. There typically is a whole backup generator and then a schedule of sort of that maintenance for that. And probably the most recent application of this would be up at the Emerson Way subdivision. So I think it would be beneficial to have a clear protocol in the covenants that indicate to the homeowner, although the covenant documents are so thick that they might breeze right over, but have a standard for the association to understand what they do when something goes wrong with the pump station. That's sort of a typical way to handle it. But that certainly could be incorporated at the definitive subdivision submittal stage.
So we'll go through and ask questions of the applicant, and then we'll open it up for public comment, and then we'll close public comment, and then we'll go back and have our discussion. Questions, John?
Just on the bike path and the road, bike path is 10 feet, road is 20 feet going in.
Right.
Does that mean we have 30 feet of continuous pavement
No, there is a, there's a grass strip between.
Okay, so there's like a tree lawn or something?
There is a tree line.
Okay.
The 10-foot wide multi-use trail is in the inner line is in the traditional side where the sidewalk starts.
Okay.
And so it projects 5 more feet.
Okay.
Sort of.
But it's not, it's not a 30-foot wide.
No, no.
Yeah, and the regulations ask for a 7.5-foot tree buffer with trees spaced 35 feet on center. So there is that separation between bike path and road.
Okay.
Mark.
Carolyn, can you go over the issue about the connection from Oak Tree Park?
Sure.
Mm-hmm.
So, actually, you can kind of see it in the picture. Eric, if you could pull that out of the camera. But, whoa, I don't want to poke you in that, sorry. So the park, Oak Tree Park is on the corner where the motor turns here, and this was all sort of conceptually contiguous with the open space here, but the proposed layout shows lot lines going all the way to the edge boundary. So the idea is just to make, yeah, just to make a connection, and Eric, I'll let you point there so I don't poke, point. But make a path connection. It doesn't, you know, it doesn't have to be paved or anything, but so that there is continuity and connection with all the interior pocket parks within at the State Hospital, Village Hill, so that they're, because they're intended to be public spaces, so that it's not contained, you know, by private property lines all the way around, but actually is connected to the rest. So we had talked about that initially, and it didn't show up on this plan, so I just want to make sure to present that to the board, and you know, I would strongly recommend that that be part of the definitive submission.
Yeah, I think the only discussion, if I may, is that we talked about, you know, having it meet the existing grade and not have to zigzag to make it a, we'll put it where the grade is least and get, you know, preserve a right of way for continual access for us. And I would note, I didn't mention that, but if we're preserving that large oak tree over in the corner, and that would again be a bit of a park lot.
Other questions?
It looks like the topography goes continually to the kind of northwest. Right, so how do you get the water back uphill to the green area, if that's where the rain garden and filtration system is?
So that's a really good question, because we actually don't. So the stormwater from the cul-de-sac, from the back side of the cul-de-sac, so all the roadway, we can get it back into the infiltration area. So what would typically be the public street area will go back into there, and we'll meet our drainage calculations are showing that, you know, we'll meet all the infiltration requirements, but there is going to be a new detention basin. Also, there'll be an underground overflow pipe that'll transfer between lots 11 and 12 that'll go back to that dark green area as a detention basin that'll be built behind the structures, and that'll be, you know, 8 flows. And the homes themselves have 4 infiltration units within each, so the homes that are sort of below, they're not going to be below gradient because we're still going to keep the driveways essentially at the same elevation as the road, so they won't be a lot lower, but their backyards will be down about 4 feet. So that water will go down into the detention basin.
Other questions?
Yeah.
Is there, at this time, architecturally for the design, do we know what these units are going to look like, or what?
I think, as Lawrence said in the beginning, that they're going to continue offering the units that they've offered and the Ford Crossing, same variation in architectural style, and you know, offering the floor plans and price points. That's regardless, we don't have copies today. We can bring them up.
Did you all refer to the residential architecture style guide in putting those together? I mean, we just.
Yeah, we're quite familiar with that guy during the first round of Ford Crossing. We actually had Mass Development as an architectural firm that actually does a review and sends review comments in detail. At least they did with Pequoy. I'm not sure about the other comments earlier. But so those houses have been reviewed and approved by Mass Development before.
Okay.
But again, the board's jurisdiction is not that. It's what the board's about to
decide.
Point out for me again where the front rain gardens are.
It's in the very front of the cul-de-sac.
Okay. So there's nothing over against the road?
On these sides here?
Yeah.
No, because it's the pitch of the road is such that there isn't any volume. We looked into trying to sneak a few in there, and it just wasn't enough space.
What is an underground infiltration chamber?
So it's you've probably seen them before by StormTech or Caltech. They're a half-moon-shaped plastic structure that looks like a large pipe. They're usually 30 inches, about 30 inches tall, about 3 feet wide, each one of them 7 feet long. And so you build like a, almost like a leach field, but there's a lot more volume to it because of the high arch. So it's embedded in stone, it's wrapped with filter fabric, and so the water goes in there and allows the water to leach out. And because there's a large volume, if it leaches out more slowly, you can still get more to leach out because it will hold the volume before it runs out to the detention basin.
So does it have to be above ground level?
Yes. And we have done soil borings. We've done soil test pits, and so trained definitive wells.
How far are you from the river there?
Well, that's a good question. 1,000 feet? I've only walked down there once, and it was, we were doing other things at the time.
Can you describe what would happen in the event that a sewage pump station failed?
Yeah, there's a couple of requirements by DEP that about the volume of storage that you have, that you need to have a couple days storage in the tank. But that, like Carolyn said, it's typical to have a generator with it, and it's also good engineering practice. I mean, we always do it, but I think somebody in Northampton would probably want to require it, that you have duplex pumps also, so that, and there's an alarm panel, so if one pump breaks, that there's always one pump operating. They're also on rail systems so that the pumps and the impellers can be lifted out of the pump station from above ground, so that you can call a pump manufacturer and get, you know, there's various in Springfield where you can get the pumps to have them go ahead and be replaced. So it's typically getting a good maintenance company just to be checking it on a regular basis.
So, Carolyn, would the fire and rescue want to consider the 14-foot wide street line?
Yeah, and they'll look at it in more detail for the definitive, but we also have alley standards in the subdivision regs that are 14 feet, and so the fire department has a problem with that. This also has additional width for on-street parking, the permeable pavers on the edge, so it is a little bit, it's 14 plus that additional, and since they're flush curving, there's flush curving, there should be no problem with.
Ready to open it up? Okay, Jeff and Moshe make a motion to do this. So, public comment?
Can I ask a question?
Yes, please, come up. We need your name and address.
Any questions? Thanks, I'm Janet Tapp. I'm at 21 Moser in Villachelle. I'm fairly new to this process, but I'm curious about where the garages are, and also, probably have already worked this out, but it does look tight for a fire truck to get around. If there was parking all along the street, it doesn't actually fit.
Yeah, so if it's a request from the fire department, we have done it, but we don't present a plan on it, but we use a software program that drives the fire truck the appropriate radiuses around the roadway. And it actually, the overhangs are actually more important than the actual tires, because fire trucks overhang so much. So typically you have to do a couple of things. It makes it easy here, it's not problematic. But sometimes we look at making sure the trees are far enough back and signposts right on the curb edge so that they have the ability to, even if the wheels are on the pavement, if the overhang is beyond the curb line, they can make it around. So we have run that. And we don't have a problem with emergency vehicles and with Northampton's. We use the 2-year fire truck. I don't know if we've gotten a bigger fire truck in the last 2 years, but we'll double check that.
And the garages?
Yeah.
And the garages, they're shown as these little bump outs. All of them are about 24 feet back from the lot lines. So there'll be one parking space in the driveway, and then there'll be one parking space in the garage. Some of the units, or some of the lots, are large enough that there's about a half a dozen or so units that may have two-car garages, but right now the base plans are for singular.
And I'm not quite sure. So that means the garages face the street in this case?
Yeah, the garage doors face the street, yeah. So they're the little extensions right off of the house in front of the driveways.
Are these denser than the existing Pequoy homes up there, more densely packed?
It's pretty similar. There are two separate lots. The interior lots are a little wider and a little shallower, the ones off the alley up there. So they're a little wider but a little not quite as deep. The ones on the perimeter, slightly narrower and longer. Mm-hmm. These are generally a little bit wider, but they're not as wide as the interior lots. And of course, around the cul-de-sac, you get a little extra room because you can't fit squares nicely around the cul-de-sac.
I'll add to that. Density was a requirement of Mass Development. They wanted to see as many homes in there as we possibly could put in there. So that was part of the requirement when we responded to the proposal, with our proposal to them originally.
Thank you.
Any other comments? Yes, sir.
Good question.
It's a little unusual for us to have the conversation going back and forth this way and not going this way, but it's fine. This is going good.
Hi, my name is Jay Brynes. I live on Mosier Street. In the presentation, there's reference to the Landowners Association will somehow have an agreement to deal with some of the sewage, the potential for problems and issues, and really the responsibility of the landowners. Association. Can you describe what that actually would require of me as a landowner or as a homeowner?
Well, unless you buy a unit in this area,
that's its own landowners.
That's
association.
Its own homeowners
it's
association.
Not the rest of the village hill association.
Right. There was an actual, but there was actually a conversation the other night about that, because in Village Hill there's a couple multi layers. Because there's an overall, I think, overarching homeowners association, and then there's going to be a Village Hill extension or whatever or Village Hill Northview, whatever the final name is. They'll be their own independent homeowners association because they'll be doing the maintenance also. These town roads will not be maintained by the town.
Mosier's public, right?
Right.
Yeah. So unlike you, they're actually going to maintain their street too. So you're on a public way, and this is going to be a private.
So the other question I have is, and I'm not sure to address it too, to you folks in the Planning Commission, but this development is unique in a lot of ways, and most of us, or I think all of us who live up there, really enjoy living up there, so we're here to protect and preserve kind of the environment that we bought into. But the future ownership and management of the entire Village Hill is getting to be quite complicated, because each of us has, it's kind of like the balkanization of the community. We all own, I own this part, you own that part, we all together own this part. I'm losing confidence that there'll be an ongoing uniformity to life on Village Show, you know, in terms of where the snow plows are working, where the who's picking up leaves that the trees are dropping, that are park trees versus property trees versus other things. So I'm asking, I guess, the question of I'd love to sit down with somebody, and I think it's the city at this point, because, you know, when we go to a developer, they say, well, Mass Development wants, you know, density. When we go to Mass Development, they say, well, the city wants, everybody's talking to us, the other guy wants something else. Nobody's talking to us directly. We don't get any answers directly. So I'm asking the city, I guess, to help us understand what we're about to be presented with, because it's not clear at all. It's very complicated. And then as we open up some of the access points, which I think I understand the bike path route and the walking paths into the woods, it's still not clear to me, though, will I be walking through somebody's front yard or, you know, right butting them, and will the landscape well enough so I'm not feeling like I'm every morning walking my dog right past their windows and so forth. But, you know, it'd be nice to be able to maintain the sense that we have free access into the woods without going through somebody's private property, even though we'll be on your edge. you know, it seems like, you know, that might be happening. So it might be a question of how much landscaping will be done on the hospital hillside. I think there's a nice landscaped area where that path goes behind those houses, and it seems to work pretty well. I don't see that reference on this side here. So again, just to maintain everybody's sense of private ownership of their property, and yet we're making the public way, and I think there's a balance there. Those of us who will be impinging on other people's properties don't want to feel that we're impinging on them. And if I bought a house up there, I'd like to make sure I'm not watching a steady stream of people going through there. But the basic question is, how do we come together with a property management understanding? You know, it's not maybe even a legal issue, but what do you think we're doing here? And I think as an owner, watching, you know, people are in this situation, transformations in another situation, and other things, maybe even having to go down the road with the other bike paths going over the river and things like that. Who's going to maintain it? What's the plan?
I don't have your plan, and you may think I'm a little naive, but I mean, we have neighborhoods all around town that form neighborhood associations that are quite powerful in the political sense of the town. And so, you know, I think eventually the developers leave, and when that happens, mass development's done. And then you're right, it is the people on the hill, and who this is a different situation where they have their subset. But I see it being a very active, as evidenced by people here, of an active homeowners association.
But a homeowners association is in the neighborhood is one thing, and it's political, and it's, you know, civic-mindedness and so forth. I appreciate that. But we will actually be responsible for Oak Hill Park and this park and that trail and public trail. We're actually legally owning the responsibility, not just civic-mindedness. We like to keep it looking nice, but we will be responsible legally for some of this land, trails, access issues, as I understand it, from my reading of the documents that I bought into. But they keep changing as the new plan comes up with another park, another access point, another landowners association will be responsible for this. I just don't understand what I would be responsible for, and I'd like to understand it. And then maybe we could comment on whether we're comfortable with that level of understanding or not. We don't know what we're being asked in the future be responsible for. That's the issue. It's all somehow, not now, but 5 years of mass development leads to Dallas. It's going to be ours. I don't know if it's going to be mine. That's my issue.
Mark? Carolyn, in a very general sense, if you take away the private roads for the developments, for the private roads, and all that are left are the public streets, what additional responsibility do the homeowners have on those public streets than any other public street?
Well, the only difference really is, so the streets that have been accepted as public will be plowed and they'll be maintained. The sidewalks are always, throughout the entire city, snow has to be removed by the property owners. And there are some conditions, and I think it would make sense in this case during definitive review, that snow be removed specifically by the association as it relates to the 10-foot wide bike head path. That's the path that cuts across the entire, so it's not one person responsible for a 10-foot section and then the next neighbor responsible for that, but the association is responsible for that clearing. The pocket parks are essentially private, so the association has to figure out how they want to maintain it. The only park that would potentially be public. They all have, even though they're private, they'll have a conservation restriction on it that requires public access to the parks, but maintained by the association. So Memorial Park would be the only park that's potentially going to be owned by the city and then, you know, maintained, unless there's a group up there that volunteers to. The public paths will all have public easements on them. It's required, and the connections through the various parks to connect to the bike path will have public access easements. And then only the portion of the paths that are on, if the property, which is what Mass Development has indicated, is going to come to the city at the back end, you know, on the riverside. If the city chooses, we'll maintain that depending on the materials. If the tree falls down, it would be the city's responsibility to see them.
So by virtue of what will there be an easement over the bike path? That would be a requirement of the planning board?
Yes, yes.
If we impose that, there will be.
If you impose it, and it's strongly recommended that you do, because that would have been the intention all along, that there's public access north, south, and east, west through this area, because there are public streets, and the idea is that this neighborhood is not a self-contained, isolated neighborhood, but it's connected to
So that will occur if the planning board imposes that requirement?
Yes, and I would argue for in this case, if you didn't, then you know there's a strong correlation between a waiver for the cul-de-sac, like the cul-de-sac, and having public access through that to connect to other properties around. So I think their regulations would require that just individually of this project, let alone the bigger master plan that was adopted by the planning board.
Any other public comment? Yes, sir.
I'm John Brady, Olander Drive, 85 Olander. I'm very interested in paths because we all walk those paths. And I think that you've done a good job of having two connections out through your property to existing paths. I think those are very good, and I hope they will have the right of way so that the public can always follow those routes. A couple of questions about the upper path. I know this came up in our discussion about the transformation project, and that is that this multi-use path is going, I think, along driveways. So are people going to be possibly backing on across that multi-use path out of their garages? I'm wondering if that's the way the design is. It's the way it looks like to me, and it's potentially a problem for the safety of people going along that path. Related issue in terms of thinking of the green space, there is a specimen tree that is on the corner there of Ford Crossing, and if you stand on Village Hill and you look where the road goes, if you have the road and then a 10-foot path, I'm a little worried about that tree surviving the construction under that site, and I hope that when the detailed plan is there that we can look at that, because the danger to the tree if you get under the canopy is significant, and it is a really special tree.
Is that the tree at the bottom right?
Yeah. It's this large oak tree right here, and there is a retaining wall closer to the road, but we've kept it off the drip line, so we won't be doing any grading within the drip line.
That's great.
Yeah, there's a critical root zone that we designed too, and that's one of the reasons we put that retaining wall in, is to keep that grade up and not kind of cut into that critical root zone. Like that.
Great. Very good.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Yes.
Larry Danielle, 71 Olander. I was wondering if there's any consideration for putting that path on the property line there between the two developments. What are the pros and cons of that? Because that would keep it away from the driveways, make perhaps a little bit more rural or country-like, instead of being, you know, a basically wide sidewalk. I think there are pros and cons to that. I want to know if it's been explored.
I think because of grade issues, you're saying put it behind these units up against the hillside.
Yes.
There's actually a pretty substantial grade between the transformation, at least at the beginning, between the transformation site and this site. So, you know, we looked at that orientation a little bit, but then to get it most popularly used and to have access to the most people, we continued it in its almost in its current location. That path there now kind of comes down in its location, and it kind of cuts through the front of the homes as this is now, and then comes back. So we thought to try to keep the alignment very similar.
Mm-hmm.
We had met with the planning staff and proposed to put it there.
Yeah.
My name is Ida Liebert, and I live at 65 Ford Crossing. And I just wanted to ask some questions that I'm not quite sure I understand. Kim Pequoy has been really good about meeting with us and answering a lot of our questions. And out of that, one of the discussions we had with him, and also tonight, I'm hearing that the roads are going to be private in this development and the other development, which is the energy positive homes, I think.
Transformation.
So is that correct?
This street is proposed to be private. There's one private road that will come off of what's anticipated. The Olander Loop is anticipated to be a public way, and then the connector to that will be private.
And may I ask who determined that, and why did they choose to treat those roads differently than in the area that's currently developed? Which is my understanding, those are all roads that are owned by the town. So I'm saying, why in this master overview of Village Hill are they treating the roads in these last two developments differently?
In this case, it's a design consideration. It's narrower. So our subdivision rules allow for narrower streets if they're privately maintained. It's a maintenance issue, basically. It's a little bit harder for the city to maintain that type of street. In terms of the other side, the energy positive homes or transformations, there's really just a segment for the co-housing, essentially, that it's private, so it's like a private driveway to the co-housing. So it's functions like a street, but it's a private access, and that had been floated in several different kind of design concepts over the years about having co-housing or having a common driveway serve units on one individual lot. So it's not really a deviation from where Mass Development had been sort of thinking conceptually over the years, that there might be a section that makes more sense to have units that are accessed by a private way. It reduces the total amount of infrastructure that's required, so then saves more room for either building or preserving open space if you don't have, you know, a wide right of way that you have to plan around.
Can I restate that? So I'm thinking of it as sort of an alleyway, and it's an imposition on the developer to give you that. It's a trade-off for them. They get to build that infrastructure as a private function of the project, but they get to control how the lots go around it. And so I view it as an imposition on the developer to create that access way, and it is different than the full street design. And it's, in my thinking, more like an alley, like a private alley between, you know, in the middle of a block of houses.
Well, basically, up to now, Mass Development has developed all the public roads and all the infrastructure beneath those roads, and they've turned it over to a developer and said, here are the lots off those roads, have at it. Now, and that's as far as they've gone. Everything left, like this lot here, the developer has to complete the road and the infrastructure themselves versus, so they not only do they have to do the lot, they have to get to the lot with the road and everything that goes with it. So. There's the cost and the expense that goes with that. So with that comes some design leeway, I guess, for layout and so forth. Whereas before it's predefined by Mass Development, but that's, we're past that. And now what we have left are private developments, private roads.
So what happens, I guess my question is similar to Jay's. What happens down the road when the roads start to deteriorate, when your children, my children, and everybody's grandkids start moving in there 10, 15, 20 years later, is it then, which association then would be responsible for repairing those roads? I mean, they're fine in the beginning, but who inherits that if the town doesn't own those roads? I mean, which association will it be? So that's
It's specifically the sub-area association. So each little, one of these little blocks that's been developed has their own little package of covenants and maintenance responsibilities. And then there's another one over here, another one over here. And then there's the umbrella one that deals with, you know, the big stormwater basins and things like that. So this functions like a little, you know, pod. So only those owners are responsible for the maintenance of that street.
So what I'm hearing then is for, specifically for transformations and for this project, that wouldn't be the responsibility of the overall association. It would be that particular association.
When a new owner wants to buy one of these lots, they will be given a large set of legal documents, and in it will be that agreement that you are now buying into the same thing as a condo would.
All right, and question number two, if I can just have another two, is I didn't hear what you said about Oak Park, or some, I think it was you said. Could you repeat that again? Because I had thought Oak Park, I'm here.
It's not coming, as far as I can recall, it's just going to have a conservation restriction on it. It's not necessarily coming to the city, so it's going to be privately owned by the overall association with a covenant, a conservation restriction that allows public access.
But did you say something about a trail being built on it?
Yeah. Oh, it needs to connect to the rest of the project. So without a connection to that, then yes, it would have to, it needs to have a path. And that's always sort of how it's been envisioned, that it would connect to the other parts of
the other. So will there be a path here? Yeah. Through a park?
There should
not
be.
Not through it, from it.
To it.
Up to it.
Yeah.
The idea is that a few houses that border the park should not be able to landlock it from everyone else, is my thinking on it.
That's the way the permit was issued for the original Peepoy project, and that's why there were signs that were supposed, that were posted at the beginning of the project for those, that cross-connecting trail that goes east-west through the section that has the alley, and for this park that, you know, is clearly noted this is public access space.
Right, I know there's a recorded conservation easement on it with protection for the that huge oak tree that's on there. But, you know, it was represented to me that it was a piece of conservation land. If no one ever said to me that there would be a connecting trail across it, and also at the back of it where it would connect to Mr. Peepoy's subdivision, there's a very steep grade too, so I don't know what would have to, you know, if you were trying to connect it, I guess I'm concerned that they might be in there building a trail, and then suddenly the nature of that part might change. So I'm just wondering if any of that could possibly happen.
The trail isn't through the park, it's from the, so if you go from your lot through the park and then you want to keep going, that path will allow you to cut through and end up on the sidewalk within the development.
Okay.
And so it is a steep grade, but that's why they're saying it's not going to be a zigzag, handicap accessible path. It'll just be a path of least resistance.
To the park.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you.
Do
you have a comment?
I just thought it would be helpful if you sketched it on. Where the trail is going
to
be.
Well, they don't know yet. They have to design it. So this is the preliminary subdivision.
Yeah, we will show it in the general location between 14 and 15.
Okay.
So if we need to move it a little bit to put it, we'd like to put it on the least gentle, no, the most gentle. The least steep slope between the two.
Okay, thank you very much.
You're welcome. Yeah, let me make sure, has everyone had a first round opportunity to speak? Yeah, please. Then we'll do it.
I have a I'm Leslie Peebles, and I live at 111 Mosier Street, so within the current Takeaway development. I have one very small question and then one comment. The small question is, the 10-foot wide public walkway, is that going to be maintained by the city?
Homeowners Association.
Also, okay. So it's a public walkway, but it could be, run with snow or something.
That's not the intention.
No, but if they don't maintain it, it's not belonging to the city cannot.
There will be enforcement. If there's a permit condition, the association has to maintain it. And in that case, it's the overall association, because it's another piece in the puzzle to connect. Because Village Hill has a 10-foot wide sidewalk too, so the association is responsible for removing snow on that. So it's the entire stretch. It's not just this little piece that's 10 feet wide. It connects to the one that already exists.
Yeah, I thought somehow it was separate from that, but now I understand. Thank you. The comment was just about traffic studies. I understand that there were traffic studies done before any of the development had been done. The development has proceeded, somewhat differently than originally anticipated, in my understanding. As one example, the assisted living is being counted as one household, and I think it's probably likely that there will be more than two cars associated with it. Has there been any thought to doing a traffic study in reference to the way things have actually played out?
So the original traffic analysis was done as part of the statewide environmental review process, and there was an assisted living use assigned at the state hospital. So that has not changed. That was there from the beginning. Of the master planning
development. There would not have been one house. So.
It wasn't counted as that. It was counted as assisted living. It's somewhere between 60 and 80 units. There are 83 units, I think, there. So that's the same. There was an amendment to that environmental review permitting to reflect the shift away from commercial development, so a downsizing of the total amount of commercial square footage and an increase in residential. So in that process, there was an analysis done. So that was 2010. So that was well after the project. So that was done, and there was sort of excess capacity because of the reduction in commercial. Also, from the beginning of the permitting, there were a series of mitigation requirements that the Mass Development had to undergo and perform, and they've done those. They made improvements to Earl Street. They put a signal at Route 10 and Earl Street. They were gonna do a roundabout at Village Hill and Prince Street, but they put a signal in, and so as a follow-up, they've also been required to evaluate the signal timing there and look at whether or not things need to be adjusted based on traffic. Traffic levels are much lower than modeled.
So, and just to follow on with that, so there is a Traffic Engineers Institute that comes up with the metrics that happen for different functions. Mm-hmm. So. What I just heard Carolyn say is that when it was commercial, you had a lot more coming and going that could be a doctor's office or anything, as opposed to a residence has a much lower metric for what would be in the analysis.
Okay, thank you.
I had forgotten that there was a roundabout discussed there, because there's a process going on right now for MassDOT collecting public comment about mm-hmm. projects that are needed, and I put the roundabout in for that.
You did?
I did.
We can spend that money
on. Well, I do think the light needs better timing, because
yes,
you've got
yes.
a lot of idling going on there.
We agree.
Yay.
Other comments? Second round?
Yeah, just a quick question. Is there a percentage of on-street parking per unit kind of thing in a subdivision like this? I mean, how do you figure out, is there enough on-street parking? The houses are very dense. And where are the cars going to park? I mean, it sounds like it's going to be along the inner green. And so what are the regulations, and would this meet those regulations?
There are parking requirements for multifamily houses. So I'm sure you've checked that it's going to beat those numbers, but.
Yeah, the requirement here is for two.
Well, that's on.
We don't have any requirements in Plain Village actually for parking, but we require that you show parking anywhere in the city. The maximum required is two per unit. And so if each of these has a garage unit and driveway space, that's maxed out. So any on-street parking is excess and for visitors or what have you. So we don't have a requirement. We only have a requirement for off-street parking elsewhere in the city. The maximum for any unit is two per unit.
Right. Doesn't that seem like a failure somewhere? That where do the guests come? Where do the service guy park? Where do, you know, once you start getting enough people to come into the community, just they need someplace to park.
Right, so there's on-street parking for that. That's where the.
But we don't care how much or how little. It's just one spot for the whole circle, and that would meet requirements.
Yes.
I think that what drew me to Village Hill is an intelligent, sustainable design, the concept, and having natural area nearby preserved as well. It's really brilliant and walkable to Northampton, to downtown. And so the multi-use trail is something that, a big part of that, and seems to be of great interest to people living at Village Hill. And I'm wondering, that I believe that's something in your purview, right? This is part of what you will be looking at and deciding. Okay. So I'm wondering if this is being designed in conjunction with what Transformations is designing, so that they will meet and, you know, there'll be a logical progression. Okay. And does it have to be hardscaped? Is that the idea? It has to be ADA compliant, certain 8 or 10 feet wide or something. It has to be a hard surface like what we have started with already.
Yeah, certain sections
spur.
Do.
Yeah.
Yeah. Not all. So the main north, south, east, west has to be, you know, 8 to 10 feet wide depending on which section you're on, and ADA compliant. So that's what makes the trick going down the hill. Actually makes it difficult is that section here that'll go from the back of the property to the river. You know, if this comes to the city, we would have to figure out a way to design a path that meets 5.5% grade or what have you down to the river.
So how's that going to happen? Who, you know, there are engineers designing these things, but how will that happen with other, if there are other parts? What's the process?
Well, the idea is that these all, because they're built in, you know, pods, you can't, it hasn't been designed all at once. So you've got this Village Hill comes up from Prince Street here, is 10 feet wide, so that just connects here and it'll end. And just like everywhere else in the city, things get built to the point that they can, and then when the city has funds on the city side of it, in this case, if this does come to the city, then we would figure out a design to take it to the next, to fill in the gap for the next one. And just like the Mosier Street project down here, it came piecemeal, so there's a segment here, then across the street, then the next segment was built when Jonathan Wright started building his flat buildings, and then over to the other side. So each project had to add to where
those are the sidewalks, but that's not the multi-use trail, right? Isn't the multi-use trail the hard top part that's called the Hospital Hills, whatever it is, goes behind the right development?
That's part of it, but it connects to the one that comes east-west. So there was an original requirement back in 2003 for the special permit. The planning board said they wanted to see an east-west connection and a north-south connection. So as each project comes in, those have to fit in and build that system.
Right, there's no master plan.
But there was a pseudo-master plan, which is that concept plan behind that said, okay, here's how we're going to have the path. So as each project comes in, it has to be shifted because of site constraints or the developer's desire to do one thing that might shift the path to another location. But yes, the overall concept was there, and then as each project comes in, they get pieced together.
So So I don't know if it's possible, but anyway, if that's something that you folks are going to look at, whether you will sort of look at the thing in a whole and think about whether including sidewalk areas is really sort of part of the original intention, or whether it's meant to be a little bit more, you know, woodsy and back behind things and not cutting across driveways and all that sort of stuff, and just sort of take that into account. I have no idea if something could be put here between the two, you know, if somebody stopped and looked at it altogether, whether it could be designed in such a way.
Well, and I think one way to think about this is we keep referring to trails, and then we view these others as almost alternative transportation routes. You know, these are the bicyclists.
Yes.
And so they are somewhat different, and we're working on the Leeds portion of the trail right now. The bike path. So I mean, we are building this out. It's come about incrementally for years.
And you say Leeds, you mean LEEDS?
The community.
And would have ultimately...
No. The neighborhood community that is one of the three neighborhoods in Northampton. So
uh-huh,
Florence,
okay.
And Leeds. And so we're working on a section of the path in Leeds right now.
Uh-huh.
Well, but sort of speaking to that master plan concept, yes, that one in Leeds could connect to State Hospital.
Mm-hmm.
Because you would come down into Northampton and then come out Northampton and go up to the hospital spur.
Uh-huh.
So yes, there's a master plan citywide for where it makes sense to make, or where we'd like to make those connections. And so we take the opportunity when we can, and the planning board also through its review of projects and the zoning and subdivision requirements, to plug those pieces into the puzzle as opportunities arise.
Okay, so the bike trail is a little bit different from the multi-use trail then.
Multi-use meaning bike ped.
Oh, it is?
Yes.
Okay. Confused, but anyway,
but
it sounds like it's on your radar.
I'd be happy to go over that with you in my office if you want to give me a call, and
thanks.
I can show you the master plan for the pedestrian facility, bike ped facilities. You know.
Oh, great, thank you.
There's some trails that are not going to be paved back out there,
right,
as well.
Right.
So
yeah.
The word trail is a little confusing too.
Yeah. More comments?
Good work.
John, seconded by Mark.
He still isn't.
Further discussion by the board?
It is in there,
yes,
for you.
We just wanted to make you aware of a request that may come to through, depending on the action of the recommendation tonight, that these front lots 19, 20, and 21 may be cut as A&R plans. And so they are being investigated, those, as because as the saturation goes and the length of time it's going to take to build the infrastructure, they may move to kind of complete the upper section before this is finished. So we just wanted to make you aware of that.
So in translation, that means you might carve those out and sell those, not part of the whole condo?
No, it'll be part of the whole thing, but it will be done in advance of this all being built.
Okay. Thank you. Got some notes. Do you think we ought to just discuss them item by item? I'm sort of looking for summary comments that we should give the applicant. If you've got extras, I'd welcome them. The first would be a condition for the condo covenants for the responsibility for the private sewage station.
Yeah.
I'm sure you expected that. The second would be a condition that in the project include park access, and we've certainly discussed that. These are almost formalities that we're kind of all sitting here nodding, yes, we've talked about that, but it should be in the official site plan that comes back to us on the next round. I think we would probably condition, although I accept your answer that the fire and rescue response can get around that curve.
And the fire department will review
that. It's their decision. In the same way that we take expert advice from the DPW, the fire department, you know, does their piece of this. And we might consider landscaping to delineate the paths in some way. I mean, I think there is a, and I'm not talking about the multi-use trails, but that path to get down to the park, just so that there's, it's, there's not an uncertainty as to where people are supposed to go to get down to there.
Wait, Devin, what's that point? What, you know, I didn't follow.
The path that goes to Pocket Park.
From
circle.
Ford Crossing?
No.
Lot 14. Between 14 and 15.
It's just a way to get down into a public park so that we haven't landlocked it. And it's not an ADA trail because of the elevation.
Yeah, you're just saying you'd like a clear delineation,
right.
Landscaping between the public and private.
Some
breadcrumbs. snow removed from the bike ped multi-use trail. I don't know that we have to say that. It's just something that is.
And that would have to be, that should be a condition. If they don't provide draft covenants to have that in the covenants, then that should be a condition of the definitive.
The Pocket Park would need to be maintained by the condo association, as in mowing or as in whatever, however that.
I think that's already been determined by Mass Development.
Big association.
It's the larger umbrella association.
Okay. And protect the specimen tree. Others?
Carolyn, with the tree regulations that we've been working on, would that apply to the subdivision?
Yes. So we have new tree removal standards for removal of trees.
And protection
over 20 inch. Although it's also in the subdivision regs already, so that ordinance is a little bit more detailed and it goes into, it would apply to anyone pulling a site plan. It'll go back to council next week, but by the time this application comes forward, we'll have a new reg on tree protection.
So, the big comment for me for the DPW was the sewer tabulation could be recalculated.
I think they just, Mass Development has a master tabulation and they want to make sure our segment matches into that.
Right.
So, we'll make sure of that.
So, you want a general one to address the DPW comments on the water too?
Yes, please.
So, Carolyn, you said this part will be maintained by the association consisting of all of Village Hill?
We're talking about the corner part that's outside of this
not
project.
Not
right.
The center.
Yeah,
right.
That's
okay.
Right. Because that's stormwater management.
Right.
Yeah.
But that brings up a point. Do we need to also, if we're talking about covenants, you know, do the buyers understand that that's part of their responsibility to maintain that center?
I think it would have to be because it's got a lot of stormwater.
Yeah.
Infrastructure. So DPW would want to see how that's maintained anyway as part of the annual maintenance.
Right.
We talked also just about the granite curving, which they confirmed what their intent is, but when this comes through a second time, it should be clear.
Mm-hmm.
Granite on the inside and slopes. Or on the outside and select on the inside toward the center green.
Well, and I see us eventually, as you and I have run into previously, the city probably needs to develop some guidance on permeable pavers.
Right.
And you're going to have to do some work in order to figure out which ones you want to use. And speaking for myself, I think we would use that information if you gave us the permeability before this, you know, and then what kind you picked and what the permeability was afterwards. And I think we could start building that for different types of products that are brought to us. It would be useful to us in the long run. That's not a requirement. That's a Deb wish.
Well, if we're going to push for the LID, then we need to know. Right now, there is no.
Right, but it's so site specific that we purposefully didn't specify product or, you know, requirements that they be certain things be installed under
right.
certain circumstances.
But
so it all depends on what the soils allow underneath, what the underlying conditions are. So I'm not sure that we would ever go to a spec. We'd want to review the specs for what the, you know, products are being espoused to, you know, address and make sure that the that makes sense in the calculation. Then if it doesn't, there's always the follow-up to say, okay, this isn't working the way it was designed. You got to fix it.
But if, like, in the future, if somebody for a different development want to come forward and they're short on green space and they say, well, we're now going to turn this 30% chunk over here into permeable pavers.
Yeah.
So now that's green space. But the city right now doesn't really consider that green space. And so, but we're headed in that direction. We're trying to push for that type of design, but at the same time, we don't recognize it. So we need to, at some point, figure that out.
And I accept the case by case example, but they're doing soil testing. It's just one more data point.
If I could comment, the in situ, the after it's done, is extremely hard to go ahead and do. We'd have to do a whole separate system to be able to do the calculations later, because there's no collection system under
right. The
permeable system to say, okay, this is how much is getting through. I mean, we tend to rely on, there's a couple of different centers, one at UNH, one at the University of Oregon. We tend to rely on all their testing for the data on how the products work.
I think sort of just on that note, this is, I think, a great step forward in terms of seeing a project that really is going to use, you know, on-site, low-impact design. So I think, you know, it's fortunate that the site allows for that, whereas not always the case.
Carolyn, can I go back to that question about maintenance by the larger association? Mm-hmm. So does that, is there an association that consists of everybody that lives at Village Hill?
There's a north and a south.
Right. Okay, so their responsibilities for maintenance are a moving target. Their financial obligation is growing as these additional parks get developed.
No.
Is that right?
No. The parks were already sort of identified as, you know, as these were built out. There's not an additional park in this, on this plan that will be added to the umbrella association. The Oak Park that we've been talking about has already been identified and is in that packet. Mass Development has this sort of conservation language. It hasn't yet been recorded, but there's an agreement that they will record it once the development's the site around it has been completed. But there, the stormwater was already stormwater for the entire site. There were sort of three detention areas that were identified as, you know, will be the responsibility of the entire association. But as each of these go forward, that's why there are individual sort of segmented associations that just deal with things that relate to the development or build up of that block or those couple of blocks. And then those owners are also responsible for the stormwater for the entire thing. Unless there's a stormwater system that's only unique to, you know, one neighborhood or one house or something like that.
So the people here in the audience and wherever who are living at Village Hill all presumably know that they are responsible collectively mm-hmm. to pay for the maintenance of the whole area.
Well, it's not the whole area. It's specified as to what that means.
Right. But throughout all of Village
right.
Hill.
Yeah.
Is this a formal vote, or is it like a technical review?
No, it's a formal vote. And so you want to vote on, you know, the subdivision as presented with the waiver requests and any conditions that you want to see apply.
Move approval with the noted items.
That Carolyn has been copying down.
You want me to read
that? That was about as a bridge as you get.
So, the the conditions I heard were that the curving, except for the inner circle, must be subdivision regulations for vertical granite. The path should be connected from Oak Park with landscaping to clearly delineate between the private property and the public access. The snow removal on the 10-foot wide by head path shall be done by the association. Comments related to water and sewer made by Department of Public Works shall be addressed.
Protect the specimen tree, but they would have to.
Snow removal of the.
Yeah, they did that.
And then the two waivers, the street width and the dead end.
Three waivers.
So the waiver, the third one, are you referring to the FFR? That's not so much a waiver, that's going to be an additional permit. So you can't waive it in the subdivision regulations, but they would file as part of their site plan, special permit for the allowance of that development in the FFR zone.
I can ask.
But it sounds like, I mean, there's no discussion about whether that was appropriate. I mean, if you all have a problem with that, you should let them know now. But the procedure is a different permit. It's not a waiver from the subdivision.
Would we consider changing the FFR boundary? I mean, it feels odd to have a subdivision in Forest Rivers and Fields or whatever the acronym is.
Well, there is allowance for cluster development in Farms, Forests, and Rivers. It just initially wasn't the intention all along was that that section was going to be part of the larger, and the whole, I sent in your staff report, the whole FFR zone covers the entire protected area for the state hospital over in the fields to the west of this. So this is really just a sliver, and there is a provision for allowing development. So you could potentially pitch a rezoning, but it's for a tiny sliver of the entire parcel, and if you could do either one. I think this is certainly the rezoning process is much longer.
Well, I think that was underlying my question: how far is it from the river? And so it feels like it is just the minimum ditch that we're dealing with.
It's like four units that just kind of peek into the FFR.
Any more discussion about that? I don't want to assume for us. Okay. Well. Motion was made with those conditions. Do I have a second?
Second.
Mark, second. All in favor?
Thank you, everybody.